Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Thank you for joining our session. Thanks for True to having us. This is definitely a little surreal for us, being kind of ground level product folks. We're used to being behind the scenes, in the weeds with the engineers and folks like that. A little different experience for us today, but we're excited to share some of those stories. We made bios ourselves, but I guess we can skip over that since we got that wonderful introduction. One thing I'll add there is, since starting at Peloton 4 years ago, my role's definitely shifted a bit. It's shifted much more into, you know, a managerial leadership role. And with that, my focus has been, you know, like many people in that shift, move from more individual contribution to helping to support and grow a stellar team of UX, product, and design folks. When Christian asked me to speak, and we talked a little bit about, you know, making that talk about the treadmill, I said, okay, I need someone from my team here who had a lot more to do with that project directly to myself, and that was Betina. And that's why she's joining me today, and there's two of us up here.
Cool. Is this working? Yes. All right. Thanks, bud. And we already got introduced, but like mentioned before, I sort of have two roles. One is that I work really closely with those software engineers, designers, UX, QA, et cetera, to sort of move from idea to execution. And the other is that I am a touch point for collaboration with other parts of the team. So Peloton is a software, hardware, content company, and many other things. So I am sort of the software liaison on that side. And then the third people, there's only two of us up on stage, but we wanted to just say that a lot of the things that we are talking about today have been worked on by many, many people. This is when we launched the Tread at CES this year. There's maybe 50 people in this picture. Probably 100 people worked on this product. So we are we're very excited to be able to be up here, but it's just two of us out of a big group of people who are working on this product.
Awesome. So just to level set what we're talking about today, what do we mean by second product or service? So we're not really talking about an added feature or a new version, new color of something. We're talking about something that, you know, people probably, the market might have a certain perception of what your brand is, what your product is, and this clearly adjusts that perception. It'll feel like something brand new for the consumers. Also internally, it might force you to change your existing team structures, your roles, your processes, hire new people. It might change your business model, and it might change how you recognize revenue. Perhaps most importantly, it's going to show the market, investors, consumers, that you're not a one-trick pony, that you have a potential to achieve market scale. Some examples of this, right? Google's the classic. Started as a search company and expanded into docs and maps and a lot of other things that showed they can pretty much have an infinite level of scale and be experts in many things and be different experiences for different users. Casper, a little more humble example, mattress company, but said, oh, we should expand and be the sleep solution, and therefore we need pillows and blankets and sheets. Uber used their ride-sharing infrastructure to and their network of drivers to say, oh, we can deliver food, and now you get your takeout also through Uber. Opening it up to the audience, are there any other examples that we can think of second products? Get a little participation going late in the day. Just raise your hand.
iPhone?
Yeah. Apple? Amazon? Sorry, I couldn't get...
Yeah, Amazon.
Yeah, from a bookseller to everything. Everything in the world. Yeah.
Microsoft and Xbox,
great example. Yeah, that definitely changed how we perceive Microsoft from being, you know, pure software company to an entertainment company as well. I might lose this lavalier. Any other examples there?
Netflix added their own custom, or, you know, their own shows.
Content production.
Yeah.
Cool. So going over to you guys, Betina, want to take this one?
Yeah. So you all are here with True Ventures too. How many of the people in this room are either in the process of launching, either you have launched your second product or you're working on your second product? Raise your hand. Cool. So a few people. And then the other question is, even if you're really early stage, you probably make investor decks and roadmaps and all these things. So how many of you have sort of put a second product on your roadmap somewhere, so it's something you will think about? All right, cool. glad to see that it's relevant. All right, so we're going to come back to you guys at the end of the presentation. We'll leave some time at the end. Bud's going to take it away.
Now I need this.
Oh, yeah.
All right, now we're going to pass the mic. So, yeah, keep in mind your questions and your experiences, because we'll jump back to those. So before we get into it and talk about the second product, we want to talk about our first product for some of those of you who might not be as familiar with it. So that's Peloton and the Peloton bike. Broadly, Peloton is a vertically integrated fitness technology and content platform. Our user experience is primarily bringing that boutique instructor-led fitness experience into the home, most notably through indoor cycling. So one reason we think we've been successful at that is because we kind of take the best parts of some other fitness options and take away some of their pitfalls. So instructor-led classes, boutique fitness without the high costs brought into the home. It's indoor fitness equipment, but we like to think it's not boring, it's much more engaging, it's much more social, it's not isolating. And gyms with that kind of full unlimited access to fitness, but without that commute and the inconvenience of moving to the gym. And also for some people, some people are actually uncomfortable working out in gyms, so they prefer to do it in the comfort of their home in a more anonymous way. For us, one reason we're able to achieve this is because we have a verticalized control of both the content, hardware, and software. They're all built in-house with Peloton. On our bike, what this means is that that bike over there, that's the physical bike, is actually designed by us, built through our manufacturing partners, and the built-in sensors and that capture every pedal stroke and move data to our servers, that's all part of the integrated experience back to the software, which again is built specifically to work with our hardware and content. And that content we also control, we also produce all of it ourselves. It's 12 daily live cycling classes, over 8,000 cycling classes on demand, and that is exclusively streamed to our devices and our apps. So no syndication of that content. All of this content is produced in our studio on 23rd Street in Chelsea of New York. This is a public-facing studio where real paying customers can attend. In the basement, there's a state-of-the-art live streaming production facility. So cameras are placed throughout the room and every class is streamed live. So instructors will actually see thousands of home users taking their workouts. And that instructor talent is part of our team. It's part of our salaried staff. So we get to integrate with them and work with them on a daily basis. The experience itself on the software, multifaceted. I won't go in deep on it, but it's about browsing and finding that class you want to take. It's about seeing the video player and the instructor-led content in class and tracking your metrics. On competing with those metrics on our leaderboard, which you may have a competitive experience or a more social where you're just seeing your friends and passing them by and you can give them a high five as you pass them. Or it's about tracking your performance and seeing, am I being consistent? Am I improving over time? And those are just a couple screens from each of those experiences. This also extends beyond our software and products into our community. This is one of, I think, 12 Peloton tattoos that currently exist. That's an old count, so it might be more now. We have a huge Facebook presence. Our kind of private rider group is over 100,000 people, or approaching 100,000 people, excuse me. We have about 30 retail locations around the country, and from there we hold events. People do meetups there, so the community is extremely active. And even our virtual community kind of comes together for special events. For example, we had a Guinness World Record breaking live cycling class that had over 11,000 simultaneous riders. The eventual vision for Peloton is to own the home workout space broadly. And that means going across all fitness disciplines, providing lots of different workout options, a lot more than just a bike, to say the least. But that's what probably everyone here knows us for. That's what everyone thinks of us as, the bike company. It's also how I have to introduce myself if I'm meeting someone new. You know. Oh, it's the indoor cycle with the screen on it. It's our first flagship product. And like many of you in your first product, it's what you're known for. So we're hoping to show the market that we have that potential for growth to expand. But it's a real uphill battle to do that.
All right, so that's where the second product comes in. As Bud mentioned, what we're trying to do here is say, We're not a bike company. We're not that company with the bike, with the tablet, which I say exactly that same thing when people ask me where I work. We're not a one-trick pony. We can build a second product. Here's what we're going to do. So we looked at the market and we said, what should we build? Honestly, it had been pretty clear to us as a company for a while that we wanted to look at a treadmill, and I'll go into a little bit the reasons why. Okay, so we built a bike first, but there are actually 5 times as many treadmills as bikes sold in the market. A bike's a lot simpler to build, and there's this big spinning community, so we went there first, but we looked at treadmills and we said, we want to go there eventually. So these are some of the examples of the treadmills in the market. There are a ton of them. They range from about $200 to about $20,000. Most of them have some controls and a screen of some sort. And we sort of looked at this market and we said, these are not very good looking. I mean, there's a lot of options, but from a design perspective, they're not sort of up to our bar of where we want to be from a design perspective. Second of all, they aren't really offering any new functionality to users. So if you go and you look at a treadmill marketing page, the things that they brag about are, hey, we've got 20% incline versus 40% incline, or we've got 15 fat burn programs versus 10. Who cares, right? So we're seeing a big market, we're seeing a mediocre user experience, and we're seeing something that's not really changing its offering over time. We actually thought that that market was limiting, that mediocre experience was actually limiting the size of the market too. So there are a lot of people who do like running, maybe outdoor racers or runners, but they hate treadmills. They think that they're boring or painful or both. So we said, what if we could offer a treadmill that gave you sort of the things that you're used to that you like about outdoor running? Could we make that market bigger? And then third, we were seeing this trend in the boutique fitness market. So While not as big as spin, there are sort of two things in running boutique. One is these running specific classes. Equinox has a precision running program. There's a thing called Mile High Run Club, which is in New York. But then also there is a trend of boot camp boutique fitness. So these are classes that have some portions on the treadmill, some portions off. You sort of alternate between. And if you've heard of Barry's, Orange Theory, that kind of thing, this is the kind of class that they're building. And they're really great. They're addictive. They're high energy. People love them. So we said, okay, so we built this bike that brings the spinning experience to the home. Can we do the same thing with a treadmill? All right, so back to that magical intersection of content, hardware, and software. The content in this case would be instructor-led, real-life boutique classes, both for running and in bootcamp style. For hardware, we wanted to build the best treadmill ever made, which is a big idea there. But it should be beautiful. It should work really well, even without the content or the software. And for software, we wanted to bring it all together. So the software is sort of your portal into this great workout, these great instructors. All right. I'm going to show you a little bit of what we mean. I love this video, so. Yay. All right, so every time I see that, I'm like, yay. Okay, so pretty cool. We're really excited to be at this stage where we launched at CES in January, and these are going into real user homes in the fall. But to ground this, 2 years ago, this is where we were. This is our COO, Tom. He is on the first prototype of the treadmill. It is the bike tablet, zip-tied to a $200 treadmill. So this doesn't work at all. And you might be starting out somewhere like this. You might be sort of more towards the like fancy, shiny marketing moment. But there's a lot of work in between that. So that's where we're going to be focusing the conversation today.
Yeah. So like Betina said, or alluded to, blood, sweat, and tears in those tiers of development. We've basically learned a lot the hard way about how to approach the second product. These are just a few of the things that we learned. We cut it down from a much longer list and a much longer presentation. So we're going to talk about first identifying key differentiators and investing early, and talk about one differentiator in particular that we actually focused heavily on through this development and might not be what you thought. We're also going to talk about how you can leverage your first product to build your second and gain a lot of efficiencies there, and an actual kind of warning story about when we almost lost all that leverage. And finally, we're going to talk about what we call borrowing backwards from your second product and how you can use that to improve your existing first product, thus the icons. So moving to the first learning, that's identifying these key differentiators and investing early. Fairly standard marketing 101 lesson here. To figure out your main product differentiators, you want to focus on your resources on those because that's where they'll be most valuable and most efficient. You want to make sure that you're prioritizing the risky stuff early, and those often stuff that's different for you. And you want to align the team around these differentiators, since that'll probably be where you win in the market. But for us, this, and for second products in general, we actually think about two types of differentiators. So that's differentiating from your competitors, which is the kind of the standard practice you would always do when approaching product, but also about differentiating from your first product. So with the competitors, typical wisdom there, take what they do, find the gaps, do it better. But what's interesting is that when you're building your second product, you might actually be approaching an entirely new market, an entirely new user base, entirely new use case. So maybe you're an expert in indoor cycling and stationary bikes, but you know jack about treadmills and running. So you might need to start all over and start approaching that with fresh eyes. In addition, you want to think about your first product. Where is the second product going to differ? And that's probably where you want to invest your time, possibly find new resources, touch on the capabilities that you're missing. To get us into the mood of kind of where we started, but doing it in a much condensed 2-minute way, we're going to do a quick brainstorm with the group here. Basically, what are those differentiators between indoor cycling and boot camp workouts, between running and cycling, between treadmills and stationary bikes, between spinning and boot camp? Anyone? Come on. Yes, sir.
Diversity in movement.
Diversity in movement. What do you mean by that?
So cycling is pretty typical in terms of you're sitting on the bike cycling, boot camp, you're on the ground, standing up, jumping, running.
Yeah, exactly. Perfect one. Sir?
On a bike, you're much more stable and you can access controls more easily when you're running.
Yeah, absolutely. So really difficult when you're running to touch screens, that sort of thing. Good one. Yes.
I mean, there's like a difference in, I know the like kind of competitive part of it. There's like a difference in how you would like qualify how someone is doing on a bike versus on a treadmill.
Very good one. Yeah. there's a what is a boot camp race exactly is a good question. Kind of one we're still dealing with, but yeah.
On a bike, you're dictating the pace, but on a treadmill, the treadmill is dictating the pace to you as the runner?
Yes. Good one. Yes. Who's in control of the experience, right? Yes.
In the stationary bike, you're facing the instructor. In the treadmill, the instructor's basically, you may not be facing them.
Right. Especially with the boot camp, we don't really know the orientation of your body. You might be doing a plank, a sit-up, a lunge. Those are all very different orientations. That's a good one. Anything else? The back? Yeah, I mean, there's definitely an indoor cycling, this kind of like on the seat, off the seat. Is that kind of what you're referring to?
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's a big part of the workout. Different metrics in general, yeah.
I feel like tracking data is probably very different between a bike where it's kind of controlled and running, especially if you're doing outside of the actual device.
Interesting. What do you mean by that?
Well, I mean, so I know nothing about Peloton. So the thing is, on a bike, you have like a wattage and all these things, right? So then you run, you can also track something. But if you're going to ask people to go outside of it and start doing things, you kind of, it's much harder. You can't do it, but yeah.
Right. How do you track them when they're off? The we'll take two more. Yes?
PM sounds really intense, and spin class is much harder.
Yes, it is very hard to finish a boot. And you can't fake it, what we found. When you're cycling, you can kind of just, you know, put the resistance all the way down and be moving, and you're like basically sitting. It's hard to do when a treadmill is moving.
I noticed that your bike locks you in the suit, and the new tread allows you for lots of additional exercise.
Yes, the diversity of movements, of exercises, the classes in general are much different. Great list, amazing. All right.
Okay, so we've listed some key differences between the experience that we built for our first product and for our second product. Someone mentioned that you control a bike and the treadmill controls you.
That's the winner.
That's the one we're going to talk about. All of these are true and things that we were thinking about throughout the process. All right. Controls. Very different from our bike. We knew fairly early on that this was something that was going to be a challenge for us versus working with a bike. So it turns out that you can put GIFs on slideshows, which is my favorite thing about this whole day. So in a bike, you move a wheel. So the sort of user experience there is when I pedal, the bike moves. When I don't pedal, the bike doesn't move. Simple. It's basically a flywheel with a sensor on it. Treadmills are more complex. I manipulate a control that could be an arrow button or a keypad or many, many other things. The belt moves and I try to stay on it, and that's the game that you play on a treadmill. So that means that the treadmill is really a full system of its own. It's got input and states and feedback in a way that a bike does not. The second thing is that because a bike, you're sort of strapped in and you're really close to a seat, people feel fairly stable on bikes. And the very first time that we tested on a treadmill, someone said, "I'm terrified I'm going to fly off this." Everyone has this like idea in their head that they're going to fly off the back of a treadmill. So we knew that we needed this new concept of communicating reliability, stability, and safety on our treadmill. We also really wanted these controls to be different from the competition. So Bud mentioned that there's sort of those two differentiators when you're looking at a second product. For us, controls were both. Here are some treadmill controls. I love showing these. We found that all treadmills have some sort of control and some sort of display, but everything in the market feels, or most things in the market, feel outdated and pretty technical. So you can just like count the number of buttons on the screen. This is like way overwhelming. We were looking at this and saying this design could be improved, but our instincts also told us that we could possibly improve the usability of these controls in addition to the design of these controls. So we tested. So this is an example of a test rig that we built super early on. It is a treadmill off the shelf. We sort of ripped the controls out. You can see over here, the display is actually pointing at me. So when she messes with the controls, I'm entering them into the software so that she can be following the bootcamp workout and sort of simulating what it would feel like on a Peloton treadmill. This is not a super fancy setup, but we learned that most of the controls that we were seeing were just way too slow for these interval-based workouts. So in an interval-based workout, you could be going back and forth between a sprint and a walk every 60 seconds. And if you're spending 30 of those seconds messing with the controls, you're not immersed in the workout, you're not paying attention to the instructor, whatnot. So we knew that we wanted to make this better in order to make this workout a better experience. All right. So differences from our first product: we knew we needed a control system. We knew we needed this design language to communicate sort of what's going on with that control system in the treadmill. And we knew that we needed this design focus on safety, stability, reliability. And from competitors, we knew we wanted to improve on the design and on the ability to make quick and precise adjustments. Okay, so we were very happy that we started this straight out the gate, because I'm just going to walk you through sort of our discovery of all of the pieces of this project. The first one is, what do the controls look like? These are the knobs that are on the treadmill. They are the result of a lot of hardware development. It's really great. They are at your hip height so that when you're running, you can touch them without looking at them, which is great. So you can still be looking at the instructor and the metrics and whatnot. And they sort of, I know, they look kind of cool too. So there's a new design element. So we've got a knob, great. But it turns out that we need that knob to be able to speak to the treadmill, and we need the, in order to tell it what to do. And then we also need, there are times when the knob should move, but the treadmill actually shouldn't move. So the case that we use is if you have a child in your house, you want to be able to lock the treadmill without them getting on, playing with the fun, shiny knobs, and getting hurt. Finally, the treadmill and the software need to be able to communicate with each other. So the treadmill needs to tell the software, hey, we're going to an incline of 5. And the software needs to be able to tell the treadmill, maybe we want to move the incline, but maybe we want to configure something else as well. So in order to support this, we actually needed a custom state machine and a custom protocol and all this stuff that would have never occurred to us on day one of starting this this project. All right, and then the other thing we found very quickly was this idea of feedback. So this is a short video, and I'll explain it a little bit first. But when you're, if you're messing with the control, the belt is moving, I'm looking at the screen. We need to be able to show you sort of what's going on with that treadmill very quickly and very intuitively, while also not distracting from the instructor. So there's this sort of overlay strategy. This is an example of sort of what that looks like. It's pretty minimal. Which is good, but would not have occurred to us so early on that that's what we needed to do. Bud, you broke me. All right. Hey, what's up?
Have you guys thought about like not giving people the ability to control it themselves, but rather the software to control it, given that it's kind of different from the
mic? My clicker. Okay. That is a great question. We just talked about the communication protocol. One of the things that we designed into that protocol is the ability to do that in the future. We tried out some of these treadmills that move without your participation, and we found them to be, we wanted to focus on making that control really good first and then move into possible future things like that. So really focusing on the basics. But that's a good idea. All right. My clicker doesn't work anymore. That's so sad. Okay, so we also knew that some users will want to walk while they're not in a class. So we need to support showing speed and incline on every screen everywhere. A bigger idea, a bigger project than we thought coming out the gate. Things go wrong with treadmills. So we needed to be able to show what's happening with the system, keep the user from interacting with the controls and moving the belt while there's something going wrong, and then also sort of communicate clearly how to resolve that problem. And finally, there were some places where the treadmill actually needed some more UX to just integrate with our current system. So in class, we have this leaderboard where you compete with people to win the class, right? Problem with the treadmill is that you could turn the speed up and then walk away and have a sandwich and win the leaderboard. So we wanted to keep you from being able to do that. We have a set of UI sort of like this, just showing, hey, you're off the treadmill. We're going to stop collecting metrics until you get back on. And in order to solve for some of those safety cases, we're also going to stop the belt in 60 seconds so that we know that you haven't just left and your dog's going to come by or whatever. Okay. The other thing we needed to change here was our team. So we did not have the expertise when we started this project to be able to complete it. We brought in an external vendor specializing in the hardware and software for fitness device control systems. These are some of the people who worked on this. That includes that vendor, industrial designers, mechanical engineers, software engineers, UX designers, and a whole bunch of people that I'm forgetting probably. But this project became a really close collaboration for which we needed to both go get that expertise and also change the way that we were working inside of our teams to be sort of more integrated. We couldn't just hand off. Okay, so when you're considering your second product, ask yourself a couple of questions. How is this different from your first product? In our case, controls were completely new, and we needed to muster the resources to tackle those. And second, how do you want to differentiate from the market? So those are areas in which to invest because they're going to make your product more appealing. In our case, controls with both. But if we had not been prepared really early on to invest in this, it would have been very challenging for us to complete the project.
Great. So control example, definitely an example of something fully new that we needed to build from scratch. But for most of the treadmill, we actually went with kind of the opposite approach, seeing what we could borrow from our first product. After all, we had this wildly successful product. That's CEO John Foley on there. It was a hit. People loved it. So we thought, what can we leverage from the bike? For example, the visual design language, the patterns, the base software UX for most things like finding a class, taking a class, viewing performance, a lot of that was the same. The whole video live streaming player and infrastructure to build classes. And by borrowing from that first product, we would be able to leverage on that proven success of those experiences. We would also, by just reusing tech and assets, decrease the project scope significantly. It's just less stuff for to build, so why build it twice? And that also means easier forward maintenance. So as we know, if you have a feature that spans across multiple products, if you're iterating on it, you don't need to make those iterations twice if you're sharing kind of the same code. And obviously there's some natural cross-product synergies there. So if we have the same kind of experiences on both of our products, a user that's going to be on both of those products, which was one of our goals from the beginning, that you'd have both of these in your home, they would have this kind of familiar feeling, Peloton-like experience, and all the flows would feel the same. Despite how obvious that all seems, we found that it's very easy to get distracted by the new, and that even when you have a quote-unquote innovative product like the Peloton bike, there's always this desire, especially internally, especially with our culture at Peloton, to do something brand new. We even found that if we were asked, how would this work on the treadmill? And we said, oh, that part's going to work just like the bike. The response was like, well, it's got to be something more than that. And this is a good push. This is a good tension. We want to be innovative everywhere. But figuring out where to make those investments in something new and when it's worth it is really the tricky part here. And then, of course, convincing your stakeholders of that. One of the big arguments we had, and this was months-long argument and testing that you'll see, and it came down to do we leverage or not leverage, was what are the screens going to be on this thing? And for a while, as we were trying to go through this decision, it actually put our whole ability to leverage any of our, or a large portion of our bike software at all, and put the whole project at risk for that matter. So early on in the industrial design development of the Tread, which is executed, outside of our team, but closely integrated, we explored a whole lot of options. We knew we wanted it to feel fully immersive while you were running or walking or off the treadmill, and be able to view the screen from far away if you were doing a plank or a sit-up or something like that. And we definitely wanted to look and feel elegant and different from other treads on the market. Some of these ideas were very out there. This is a projector. This is like being in Tron. And these are not even the weirdest ones that we had. Ultimately, what we ended up with was a fight between these two, a 42-inch vertical and 32-inch horizontal, not with those rail assemblies, but those screen orientations. For reference, that's kind of the scale differences between those, with a reference back to our bike screen, which is also horizontally oriented, and it's at 22 inches. Why do the big vertical screen? Well, the argument was that it was unique and innovative, and honestly that in a showroom, in the press, anytime you saw it, you'd be like, wow, this thing's amazing. This is something different. There was also a theory that a lot of video would kind of skew towards this with what was happening with mobile phones and the prevalence of video shot in that way. Also that it would be more immersive because it's big and you're like inside of it. And it matches the shape of running. So you can actually see the instructor's legs and their stride. Makes a lot of sense. On the other hand, we knew early on we'd lose a lot if we went with this. We'd have to have a whole new UI UX pattern for interacting with this type of screen and higher incremental costs in every future change. And that doesn't even mention kind of what it would take to shoot this type of content and not be able to share it across our platforms or come up with a new way to do so. So definitely a lot of cost here, but ultimately we just wanted the best experience possible and we were willing to make that investment. We actually went through the exercise of wireframing the entire experience for 42-inch screens. So this is like five of hundreds of wires about trying to figure out how a giant screen like that would work. Design team, not a fan of this, even at this stage, but still some stakeholders were really into this. Some testers were really into it at this kind of flat level when you were just looking at it on a computer screen. But to further that exploration, we really had to bring these 2D concepts to life to figure out what would work.
All right, so we did a whole variety of prototypes here. You can see some of these are just foam core things you can stand on that have paper in front of them. We found that in that case, the vertical screen looked pretty cool. It was big. It felt really good when you're standing on it and it's stationary. We also filmed a whole set of content in both horizontal and vertical and had people run on the treadmill with it. Some of the examples here, we're all internal folks. So this is some of the video from our testing on the side here. We found a few things. First, that sort of wow moment with the vertical screen was just that. It was just a wow moment once, and then the novelty really wore off quickly. Second, both screens were really big and immersive. So if you were close to it, a 42-inch screen and a 32-inch screen, you were really there either way. The third one, which was kind of surprising to us, was that when you're testing with a vertical screen, some of the users were actually feeling nauseous. So the instructor's sort of bouncing up and down, you're bouncing up and down. There's such a thing as too immersive, as it turns out, in this case. The last piece is that this vertical screen, when you were actually interacting with it, it was really hard for many users to touch the top or the bottom or see the top or the bottom. So when we were, I'm sorry to turn off this video, I love it, but we're gonna go. But we actually started drawing out like what areas of the screen were actually usable for these users. And it turned out to be about the size of the horizontal screen anyway, right? So we couldn't put UI there, we couldn't have people touch that. So the benefits of having all this additional screen real estate were really being lost to it being out of sight of people's reach and eyesight. So once we looked at all this together, we all agreed that 32-inch horizontal was the better choice. It allowed us to leverage what we built with the bike without having to trade off anything in the user experience. This was really good because, as Bud said, this was a month-long argument. So it was good to have the testing come in and be pretty certain about the right path for us. And from a software perspective, this allowed us to tweak and repurpose a lot of the screens in the app. So this is a small portion, but everything from finding a class to looking at your workouts after the class. It also means that we can share this software between the bike and the tread. So our goal is that in the future, when we want to add something to the bike or the tread, we can add it for both at once and just make tweaks based on the experience instead of having to build a full new thing for each. All right, so to recap, leveraging what you got might feel like an obvious strategy, felt super obvious to us, but be careful. Sometimes you should leverage from your first product, sometimes you shouldn't, and making that decision is really important, making those decisions correctly. Okay, so we've talked about innovating, we've talked about leveraging, we've mentioned the tension between the two. The third thing that we learned that sort of surprised us was the ability to borrow back some of the efforts from your second product to improve your first product. All right, why is that important? If you've been working on a big launch for a while, that work is not actually helping current users. In our case, a significant fraction of our team was working on the tread. Users weren't seeing that value. And it's easy to sort of lose the innovative momentum with those users. If you can find a way to bring some of that value back to the first product, everyone's happy. Second, if you've been working on a new product at a existing company, you're probably sworn to secrecy. These are some of the crazy things our lab. We have like this facial recognition thing for no reason. But we couldn't have external people come in and test. We couldn't talk about the product. So it meant when we were building features, we had to either build them blind, test internally, or find a way to launch them in our first product so that we could sort of learn before we launched our second product. And finally, it's just not a great idea from a software development perspective to launch a whole bunch of code at the same time. That's a good way to find bugs like right after you launch. So we really wanted to launch this code in pieces if we could, and if we could borrow it back to the first product, we could sort of do that under the radar.
So I'll speed through this one to try to get us some time for Q&A. One thing we borrowed back was what we call segmented timelines. This goes back to some of the differences you guys mentioned, where you have on and off the tread segments and a diverse set of workouts. So this is a complexity on the treadmill that just does not exist on the bike. And that question is really, how do we explain a complex bootcamp class to users? What's upcoming in the class, if you're already in it, what to expect if you're about to join it, how do you understand your performance afterwards by explaining the segments of that class. We came up with this concept of segments, basically a subsection of a workout that explains basically, you know, what's happening during that segment in a very simple way and with a visual language that we were able to communicate consistently across different parts of our experience. This is just a little part of that visual language. This is some of the iconography that talks to what the segment is if you're just looking at it on the timeline. And that timeline, those collection of segments when displayed in the class is something we call the segmented timeline. So you can see yourself moving along this progress bar that is also an understanding of not just time, but sections of that class. We also use this same data to show you what's going to be in the class before you start it. So in our pre-class detail screen, you can see the itinerary of the class using that same data presented in a slightly different way. In your performance, you can also see it. It's overlaid right here over your graphs. So for example, if you're looking at your output graph, you can say, oh, during this cool down period, I decelerated a bit, and that makes sense because that was what happened during the class. Or during the strength segments, we're not collecting that running output, for example. This is a huge cross-functional effort besides that front-end piece. It's between us and the content team to kind of figure out what would those library of segments be. We actually did an interesting collaboration where we would watch a bunch of test content and everyone in the room would write down what they thought the segments were. And this varied drastically. Some people would put 30 or 40 segments in a 40-minute class. Some people would put 3. So we had to kind of come to a conclusion there. We also had to build an internal tool. These are wires of it, but the production team would use in a live class to actually mark these segments. So they could pre-program it, but if the instructor went off script, they could at any time kind of mark, oh, this is a live class. The instructor suddenly got off the tread, is doing something different than we thought, so we have to adjust on the fly. Because of all of this massive effort and all of this risk, we were touching major screens in our experience. We wanted to figure out if there was any way we could start to de-risk these features by getting them out in the wild. Naturally, we asked, could this be useful for our bike users? And we basically set it up as a quick beta. We had built it for the tread, but we couldn't release it for obvious reasons. And this was almost a year ago at this point. And we just started having people use them, and they said, oh, well, if you could tell me when the warm-up, the cool-down, the weight segments were, that would actually be really valuable to me as a cycling user. So eventually, we did start to record segments for every cycling class and then launch the front-end features to bike owners. And almost more importantly, the massive amount of code into this whole new bike UI that came packaged with this segmented timeline. So by releasing all that to our bike users, we significantly de-risked these big changes on our most critical screens and gave the bike users immediate value. As a reference, this is what it looked like before we released that segmented timeline. So the timeline's added, but it's also a whole new redesign. This is actually a more recent screen than the screen that Christian showed during the presentation today, which was from like 4 years ago. So we did this with a lot of our screens. So we would build what we needed to build for the treadmill, for a variety of different reasons, and then we're like, oh, this is a better experience, and we want to have one set of code. Let's port it back to the bike. At the end of all that, and without going into too much detail, we kind of ended up with like a whole new look and feel and base UX for a lot of our core software experiences, and it was stuff we were already building for the treadmill, so we were able to leverage an incredible amount by borrowing back. So for this new thing that you're building, figure out a way to give immediate value to your existing users by borrowing back some of it, and also de-risk that new thing by putting it out early, putting pieces of out early. And essentially what we did was we used our bike owners as secret beta testers, which was really effective.
All right, so quick recap, and then we'll get into questions. Our first lesson here was to identify key differentiators. The difference with the second product is that it's not only key differentiators from the market, it's also from your first product, because your first product, you know the most about that, and you might need new resources or expertise to tackle this. We talked about controls in that context. Second, leverage your first product when possible. It can get really challenging in a world where you're trying to build a new product to look back and use what you have, but we think that's really important in developing this product. Third, you want to see if there is a way for you to borrow back some of the features from your second product to improve your first product. This is a good way to deliver value even when you're working on a new product and devoting a lot of your resources there. Okay, it's question and answer time. So we are interested in hearing two things. One is questions about the Tread, but we also are really interested in your experiences building second products. And if you had similar or different experiences from any of these, we are not the expert. We've done one. So any questions? What's up?
Well, I'm curious, in this dialogue of borrowings, one of the most important brand experiences in your bike, it was a very loud orange dial, and I wonder why some of those visual cues did not transfer to the new product.
Good question. Good question. Definitely lands more towards the industrial design team. It was there. Some of the knob designs did hold that, but I think what we wanted to do is we found out we needed some states with the LEDs, and to make the LEDs kind of, we didn't get into the LED ring a lot, but it actually displays some ambient lighting that tells you what's happening on the acceleration deceleration. So when we had to make that kind of shine, we went with a much more pushback dial. I think it was mostly an aesthetic choice and a slightly functional one.
Introducing a second product alongside a first that will exist in the market begins to imply having a platform on which you have products built. How did you as an organization change to deal with having a platform and products built upon that platform? How did you, did you split the teams to focus, some of which are focused on platforms, some focus on product, or?
Yeah, great question. So the way we did it in this case is we did devote a team to the initial kind of R&D, UX, and build of this product, especially some of the things we pointed out here that were built Tread specific. And this is, you know, a team Betina led from the product side. And during kind of that first year, year and a half, a lot of what this team focused on is those Tread specific things. But as you saw here, a lot of that stuff ends up being platformatized, right? It ends up being part of one common code base. More recently, that team that was called the Tread Scrum team or set of Scrum teams is now just one of several bike Tread teams or hardware software teams, as opposed to our app software teams that doesn't involve hardware and the user experience. So now when we're building features across those teams, we're not aligning it to a bike experience or a Tread experience for the most part. It's more like a team dedicated to social experiences, to consistent workout behavior, to the in-class experience. And almost everything we build, I'd say 95%, is cross-platform. We also have, under the hood, a shared set of APIs and a platform team that's managing our streaming infrastructure, our content CMS. All of that is also shared. So very much, literally, a single app that's being pushed to two screens, but because of the content and some slight differences in metrics and some of the stuff we talked about, feels very similar and is very similar.
A lot of talk about like hardware and software and the way that like the user experience is integrated between both. Super curious how like what collaboration looks like between a hardware team and a product team when like a brand new piece of hardware that is also this insane is like on the table.
It was very fun. It is actually very interesting because the bike has been a fairly mature product for a while. And so while hardware, software, and content had to work very, very closely together very early in that product, we had started to be more in different lanes. And so the experience of building this treadmill stuff was bringing key people from those teams really close again. Working with hardware is interesting. I think every team has different culture, right? And so when we were, oh no. Everyone, you want to see my password? All right, so when we were working with the hardware team, we really needed to learn to speak each other's language. So sometimes you'd say something and the hardware team would sort of look at you blankly or vice versa. We don't know anything about manufacturing, right? They're thinking about how something looks and feels, not how it's going to affect the software. And so honestly, it was like lots of hours, lots of communication and trying to explain ourselves to each other in order to get this through.
And just to add to that, one thing that was, you know, surprising to me. So there was a counterpart hardware product team, VP of product there, product managers, kind of industrial designers that paralleled our designers. And definitely a learning experience for me, just seeing how different the hardware process was. Very long tail, very waterfall. And it was challenging for us, as you can see, so much of our process was testing. And just a lot of the hardware process was just waiting for like a mold to be ready or like a new prototype. And we wouldn't really have a chance to make integrated decisions. So there was a lot of conflict there too sometimes where we're like, you know, when is that part coming in so we can test it with our software? So there's challenges as well, for sure.
It was also fun because for a while we were waiting. We couldn't test without having a treadmill. So we'd be like, guys, are you going to have a control system? And they'd be like, yeah, someday. Yeah. What's up? You had a question?
Sure. So now that you've taken a plunge with a control system for the tread, can you borrow that back to a bike 2.0 that has like constant power rather than just constant resistance, for example?
That is a great idea. I can't really talk about future product development. That's a good idea. It is something that we think about borrowing back on hardware and content and software. So it's something we're thinking about. Yeah.
If we were building something like that, then we would, yes, exactly, be able to use some of that technology. And you know, we've talked about that hypothetically, for sure.
How often are you shipping feature releases?
It kind of varies team to team by their cadence. Like, for example, like our iOS team like has a slightly different cadence. But I would say we're releasing weekly across all teams, sometimes multiple times a week. But big features, it really varies. We've actually done something we used to release them basically as we've had them. As we've gotten bigger, we've been trying to make a little bit more of like a marketing moment around some of these releases. So we've been holding them and batching them together to kind of build a story around it. So there's some strategy there. But a lot of this stuff is done and behind walls or behind betas or released to a small group, you know, on a weekly, bi-weekly basis.
Do you find that most of those releases come with an announcement to your users, or do you let your users discover these opportunities in the product?
I'd say it depends on the scale of the feature. I mean, it's a feel thing. I mean, there's constant like modest UX UI improvements that, you know, like, oh, we completely changed like how our filter UX on the leaderboard works recently, but we didn't want to announce that because it just like, it's too like inside baseball a little bit. So we let people just kind of discover it and test it in the background, but it's not really heavily talked about even because it's that invisible UI type thing. But I'd say most things we do announce, but the scale of the announcement varies a lot. You know, is it just an in-app announcement? Is it an email that goes out? Is it a post on our social page? We have different techniques.
When it's time, did you know it was time for a
second product? To be perfectly honest with you, we were told. I'd say it's like a little above our pay grade, the base decision of whether to do a second product. One day it was just like, you know, we just recently announced we're going international. That was also similar, like, hey, you're going international, and get ready. And then us figuring out how to do that, how to make it work the best. I know a little bit that a lot of that decision was self-driven by Peloton as opposed to our board. I know some stories where the board was like, you guys are doing so good with the bike, just keep selling them, don't mess this up. But we, like I said earlier, we wanted to be more than the bike. We didn't think we could ever kind of grow exclusively in the cycling market. So I think this was always known, always talked about from kind of day one with the founders. It was just kind of, when did we have realistically the capital to make that investment? Because there was a huge capital investment that comes with the hardware there.
how long is that cycle from the moment that the piece being there until we should build a second product to actually launch?
The first brainstorm on this was in June 2016. We are shipping to homes this fall. So pretty long time. And you know, varying amounts of investment throughout that process. Obviously in the early stages, it was just a lot of design and UX and stuff like that. And you know, now it's kind of fit and finish and software features and manufacturing stuff. But yeah, it's been a little over 2 years.
From a user perspective, you think about your users as runners and cyclists, or is it somehow complementary from a user perspective?
That's a great question. So we actually have several personas for running that are separate from cycling, but one of them overlaps. So there are users who are really interested, who are cyclists and they're never really going to run. There are users who are runners who are never really going to cycle. And there are people who are just really interested in getting sort of a full workout. And they might have both or they might have one. So this is something we've thought about a fair amount during the product development process. The answer is both. Yeah.
Now that you have two products, what does the process look like for prioritizing features between the two? We can get a twofer for both products or focusing on one versus the other.
Yeah, so we really want to launch features on both products at the same time. So we definitely, when we're looking at a new opportunity or a new feature, we are thinking about how to have it be on both. And then the way that we prioritize sort of bike-only features or tread-only features is a little different, given that our bike is live in the market, real users with real pain points, and the treadmill is this new thing that's sort of we want to get it into the market and get it tested, right? So I would say when we're looking at a bike-only feature, we're saying, how many users does this help? How big is the pain, et cetera, et cetera. For the tread, we're still saying, is this what we need? Do we need this for launch, right? Because we can help our current users.
Very much an MVP approach to tread. We're trying to keep that scope down because it's going to be a lot less people to start out with, just naturally. We just don't know enough in many cases.
How is the pricing determined for the second product?
It has a lot to do with cost of goods. Again, not kind of like our area, just generally, it's a formula with cost of goods and margin, and then a little bit of like pricing research, large scale surveys that say, what would you be willing to pay, that show kind of the price elasticity. What I can say generally is that this treadmill, let me see. My counsel's here, so I'm not sure what I can say. the reason we're able to produce such an amazing treadmill that many people are comparing to $20,000 treadmills is because we have this subscription model. So we are not exclusively looking to have our margins made on the hardware itself, where every other fitness company, every other hardware fitness company is.
What is the sell? Is the sales strategy on the tread mainly new user acquisition? And what do you think that'll do to your bike from cannibalizing the sales?
We think it's a little of all those things. So definitely new user acquisition, right? So you're going to have a whole new market. I mean, we talked a little about the treadmill market being huge, about the running market being huge, about bootcamp fitness being huge. These could all become much bigger than spin in many ways. I'd say more so when we think about it, we think about an ideal where a user would have both or otherwise be doing both types of exercises, because this content is also going to be available on our app. And you will have access as a subscriber to all of our platforms, and it's really just all of our fitness content products, and it's really what types of hardware you want. So we're trying to build that home gym out and give you access to all those different types of content. We don't really worry that much about the cannibalization in that case because it's the same subscription ultimately. You, for example, if you pay $39 a month, you get, and you have a treadmill and a bike, you only pay $39 a month. You don't pay it twice.
Any other questions? Yeah.
You talked about having different, you guys are a product on the software side, and you talked about having product on the hardware side. How do you come to decisions about things like what the hardware controls are versus the software controls?
I mean, it's like a lot of other things. I mean, it's very collaborative, and ultimately through testing like this, we usually land at the same place. You know, we do have some tiebreakers in those arguments. Tom, our co-founder, kind of overarches over both of those departments, but it really rarely comes to that. It's really just more about that kind of creative process, not unlike within the product team, the software team itself, similar types of conflicts. So it mostly operates as one team in that way. Yeah. Cool.
I was just going to ask you, we've touched on a little bit of differences between hardware, software, waterfall versus agile, and in timelines. I'm wondering if, and you mentioned also complementary organizations or structures, do you guys have an overarching product development process with similar milestones, check-ins, that sort of thing?
So the way that we sort of reconciled the two different processes was we had shared milestones along the way. So we knew pretty early, here's when we want to open the studio, and here's where we want to have first prototype, and second prototype, and third prototype. And we were aligning software with that, and also content. So we actually were doing rounds of content prototyping at the same time. And so we found that even if we didn't need to know everything that happened on every team in order to hit that milestone, we just needed to have a good, clear set of intermediate milestones.
Yeah. Hardware would kind of like have one release going to that milestone, and we might have a lot. And content team might just like start there and do the prototype. And then there was several of these. But we kind of checked in at those locations, obviously a lot of collaboration between, and said, and then we were able to have a cohesive round of like testing this beta one, beta two, beta three type thing. Cool. All set. Thank you,
right,
everyone.
Thank you. Appreciate it.